Retreat, and I'm with
Hanna from What's River Brewing, and we're really excited. Oh, I'm gonna jump. I'm gonna wreck our whole schedule and just say that at the end of this episode, we're going to introduce what we're doing next week, and it's something that's in our mate's case that What's River is selling on our website. And the reason I want to jump in and tell you now is because if you book buy something from our website before midnight, we will be delivering to Melbourne and Geelong tomorrow. So that means you could have in your hand the thing that we're going to taste next Wednesday. So, back to you, Rebecca.
Hi, it's Wednesday Winos, and thanks, Hanna. It's hump day, and as usual, we love to celebrate all things Yarra Valley, beautiful, delicious, and we don't want to do it alone on a Wednesday and hump day, and today we're drinking Cedar Fox with Craig from Cedar Fox Distilling Co. Welcome, Craig, to Wednesday Winos.
Thanks for coming, Craig. We're really pleased to have you on. One of our
old friends
at What's River.
So while we're waiting for, I'm pretty sure we're online right now. So if they just send us a hello in the comment box below, we'll be able to say hello. And also, if you've got any questions for Craig and Cedar Fox Distilling, anything about gin, just let us know in the comment section because we can actually ask Craig as it goes along. So welcome. So Craig, would you like to tell us a little bit about yourself, introduce yourself, and Cedar Fox Brew Distilling.
Yeah, well, as you said, my name, and I'm Craig, and I'm the, I guess, part co-founder and distiller of Cedar Fox Distilling Co, which officially, well, launched our first, you know, release of a gin and a barrel-aged gin in late December 2017. So, it's already a few years tick by now. Very small operation based in Coburg in the northern suburbs of Melbourne. I do some seasonal sort of things every now and then, but it's, predominantly at the moment, it's my startup sort of, I guess, business or gin distillery. Not that I'm limited to gin. I'll be hopefully doing whiskey and things down the track. So, I guess that's kind of the basic for the base of what I do. Yeah,
fabulous. So we're drinking your white gin, I guess.
Yeah,
dry. Yep.
So yeah, it's kind of a London dry. I guess it's loosely. It's you know, a bit of a contemporary edge, but it's also based in a London dry.
So because we all drink together, how do you suggest we drink it? I've got some ice, tonic water.
Should we be tasting it neat so that we can talk about it, or should we be mixing it?
Look, it's always good to try something neat first just to probably get an appreciation of what's in there, and maybe dilute it a little bit just so some of those oils and those volatiles break out a little bit. I mean, it's the same kind of principle with the Scots like to add a little dash of water to their dram and whiskey because it helps release some of those compounds that you know, help open up the whiskey a bit. And it's just, it's not too dissimilar with gin. There's a lot of aromatics and flavors in there that we go to great pains to infuse in a neutral spirit. And so if so you're kind of already throwing it into a mixer with like tonic's quite dominating, so it can hide or mark some of those the gin qualities or botanicals that you're looking for. Yeah, so it's always good to nose that and maybe have a taste and then, you know, add your tonic. But then I'd always be cautious about the amount of tonic that you put in there. Yeah, look, the Cappy Dry is a good one. Anything that's not overly sweet or too potent, like, yeah, I guess you can get like everyone. I have met people who said they didn't like gin and tonics, but then they realised it was a tonic water, not the gin, so it was actually all they were tasting. And you still get a lot of crimes against gin and tonics in some venues where they just slam a whole bottle of tonic water in there and with a dash of gin. So you may as well just be using rubbing alcohol because you're not tasting any gin.
It's just the tonic that you drink.
Yeah, you're just drinking ethanol and tonic water. Actually, Ty Danbergs, who was a Hillsville brewer at White Rabbits, he put me onto a good technique, which was tonic and soda water. Oh. And then gin, and then that helps kind of cut back on the tonic's influence and helps let the gin come forward a bit more.
Do you sniff it like you would sniff a wine or a beer, or is there some
Look, there's a lot going on there, and not just juniper berries as well. I mean, juniper is the main ingredient in there that identifies it as a gin, but there's a lot going on there. I mean, I have Lebanese cucumber, there's Maya lemons, rosemary, lemon verbena, and Szechuan peppercorn and coriander seed in there. And there's a lot of other gins out there that have even, you know, a vast amount greater quantity of different botanical variations, and the way that they play together can create different aromas. So, yeah, I would always do that. Not that I actually do it myself all the time. A lot of the time I'm just thirsty and I just slam it down sometimes. So
speaking of which, so we can actually cheers each other before we do. And shall I throw in a garnish? Which one would you pick? I've got a cucumber.
Yeah.
Or orange.
Look, I do like orange actually.
Ice?
Yep, ice, yeah. That helps. And then when that sort of starts to melt down, it helps a little bit. No one wants to drink a warm beverage. Cheers.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, come on, get to it. Yeah, come on. Catch up.
I'm too busy garnishing. And what about soda? Because I quite like a dry beverage and I find tonic a bit sweet. Like,
yeah, so soda's really good for drying it out, yeah. Even if it's just like, you know, a soda string, homemade soda, if you can. No.
So I've got a question. Why cucumber? Why would cucumber be used as a garnish? And why do you have it as an ingredient? Because you were mentioning it before.
Well, it's ingredients that are around. Someone just said, why cucumber? Why not? it's an ingredient that's, my wife's Lebanese and my in-laws are, you know, by default Lebanese. it's a common staple around the household. And fresh, a really good quality cucumber, freshly cut, does have a great aroma that complements gin. I guess Hendrick's is probably the main, sort of the most popular one that's a cucumber-driven gin. I guess Cedar Fox still is more juniper-driven, but there is a cucumber element. But it does work. It doesn't. It depends on the mood. Sometimes I don't put it in there. But yeah, it's not an essential one, but it's always good to mix it up. I think cucumber and thyme actually go well together.
Mm. I do like the rosemary. I had a cocktail, gin cocktail, when I was traveling in Europe way back pre-corona, and I didn't think it would mix, but yeah, the two, rosemary and gin goes really well. What's really interesting is that we put in the cabins, we have your little bottles, and I want to talk about that a little bit because they're actually really cute. They're the, have you got the big bottle there?
Me, yes.
So, I mean, my hands are small, so maybe they look the same size. But the interesting thing about these things is that I was looking for a small gin bottle because in the cabins we had lots of wine, we had beer, but not everyone drinks wine and beer. And I approached Westy because of your connection that you had with Watts River and White Rabbit. So first question. Can you tell us about the connection that you have with Healesville, Yarra Valley, and also White Rabbit and Watts River? Because it's quite an interesting story.
Well, White Rabbit was my first professional, I guess, alcohol industry job. That was my entry level. I'd been amateur, like homebrewing, for about a decade. And some of the friends who were, you know, who were actually working there, particularly Alex Troncoso, he I used to send him beers all the time just for, you know, feedback. Even when he was over at Little Creatures in WA in Fremantle. And we actually met through more music circles, on, you know, online music circles, and then discovered we both were into beer and home brewing, and then that relationship started there. So when an entry level position came up at White Rabbit, and I was, you know, I wasn't a spring chicken either. I was 40, just turned 40.
So young.
Yeah. So I was doing, I guess, the life change, a career change. I've been in IT for about 15 or so years, for a long time, and hated that. I was over it, you know. But then I managed to land a job, you know, significant pay cut. I lived in Coburg, so it's quite a distance. It was, you know, pretty much a 2-hour round trip. But I worked out there working with, you know, a steep learning curve and doing a 2-hour daily trip, really, just to do it. And my wife, you know, the other part of Cedar Fox wasn't interested in relocating to Healesville. She's a city girl at heart and always will be. So, but I spent a lot of time and a lot of my early training and just basically learning from really talented, smart brewers who I have a lot of respect for then and still do, and have maintained a really good friendship connection with the community out there, you know, because a lot of them are still out there. So, yeah, I spent a lot of time out at Healesville just through that work, and it was a really good life-changing part of my life, a big influence on me. And, yeah, just the level of competency and knowledge was really left an impact on me, and I've always, you know, always had a fond connection with Healesville ever since because of that start that I got and where I am today, really, of being my own, I guess, manufacturer, producer of booze, and part of that journey started there. So I guess that was kind of the first step in me actually kind of not just dreaming about what I was wanting to do, but actually, you know, the first step in making it happen. So, yeah, I could go on much, much more about my fondness for those times and the people that I worked with there.
Yeah, so it was really interesting when I was actually on the scout for little bottles and something, a boutique, small independent brewer that did the small bottles. Ben from Watts River Brewing was like, hey, give Westy a call because he's actually thinking about doing it for coming up to Christmas and maybe he'll be interested in doing that. And what was really cool is my other half of the Kangaroo Ridge bit was he was a bit more skeptical about that, the people drinking a smaller bottle of gin. The big bottle would be way too much for a weekend trip. I mean, in terms of, yeah.
But it is so delicious.
Yeah.
So,
I'm not sure if you could take it home, but yeah, they actually are quite popular. And yeah, so that's, you'll see that in Kangaroo Ridge Retreat on the shelf there. You can purchase it part of the larder system. So that's how we know Cedar Fox.
It's a good sample. It's something I was experimenting with. So the experiment still continues with different size formats. It's not like a cocktail minibar size, but
bigger.
Again, I'm a very small operation. I'm pretty much, I do everything myself. And like every bottle that's out there, small or big, has been filled and labeled, packaged by myself.
It's pretty, and these come in a pair, right? If you were to order this from you as a gift,
I do online, they're the only ones. I don't really sell those ones except direct online, and they're in a two pack. So you get a sampler of a small bottle of the barrel aged version and the I guess our signature gin. It's a good way to sort of people get introduced to both of them without having to commit to a larger bottle. They're good gift ideas for birthdays and Mother's Day, Christmas, things like that.
So the other one that we have, I guess, would be the...
Can we taste it yet?
Yeah, I'm like pulling up, so can we taste this one?
So this is what I'm really excited about. I love the barrel. I love wood, as people who have watched this show before. I'm a big fan of wood. So this is barrel-aged. Before I get into it, Craig, tell me, should I be mixing this with something or
not? I don't think there's any golden rules that you know, if you purchase it, you can pretty much use it as cologne if you really want to or whatever you want to do. But there's suggestions which help enhance the experience of what you've got. So, if you've got a bottle of Coke, you can pour it in there if you want, but you're going to be missing that. Who am I to tell anyone what to do?
If I really want to taste the yolk,
and because
I love the wood.
You would a whiskey, you just would maybe have a bit neat, maybe add a dash of water and then let those aromas come out, because it's still identifiably a gin, but it's been rested in ex whiskey barrels as opposed to some of the other ones which have been in a wine barrel, for example. It's a spirit that's been aged in another ex spirit barrel. And now it's Australian Pera. So originally the sherry barrels that then had Australian whiskey. And so it takes on some of that character, and there's some whiskey notes there. But, as each subsequent fill occurs, then there's probably less and less of that character. It's not a big kind of mover. It's more of my little specialty pet kind of project. But I happened to have it ready when I was ready to launch the other gin, so I did them both at the same time because I could, because I'm just on the boss. And can make those executive decisions.
We have a discussion.
Discussion with myself.
I love it.
But that's a good one, Nate. But it's also, it does a really good dry martini. So you can, it wears different hats more so than a regular gin, because it has the brown spirit kind of character. So you can do a really good old fashioned with it. That's a fine way. Maybe sometimes I garnish with I'll put ice. I'll either garnish with some orange or even pear works really well. Some spiced pear works well with the oak gin. But you can do a good variation of a whiskey old fashioned. So instead of doing bourbon or American whiskey or whatever, you just do your sugar syrup, ice, and bitters, and it comes up really, really pleasant. And quite powerful too. So you have a couple of those, you'll know it when you try to get up off your feet.
It's
45% and the other one's 42%.
Yeah.
Is that right?
Yeah. My go-to though lately has been martinis, for both of them anyway, with a really good vermouth, dry vermouth. Doing martinis has been really good with both of them. I enjoy them quite a bit.
What other gins do you actually make?
Apart from those two, I've done this seasonal, I do a pomegranate infused gin in the summer. So it takes me a whole year to kind of prepare that because the fruit generally is not ready until late summer. So by the time summer's kind of nearing ending, when you should have already had it out, the fruit's kind of a bit delayed and tedious to prepare. So did it last year. We did about 5 kilos of the pomegranate pulp, not the actual husk. You've got to dehusk it all and pull the little fiddly bits out. And I macerate those in ethanol until basically all the colour and flavours come out. And then I just put that aside for the whole year. And then when it's coming up to probably spring, I'll then start blending that with a gin that I've made that's had some pomegranate infused in the vapor infused as well. So it comes up really well. And I'm very mindful not to make it into a liqueur. Like, I guess I don't want to make a slow gin out of it. It's not overly pink. Whatever, you know, colour is there is there. Although I found that the pomegranates after time, the colour starts to yellow and not be pink anymore if it's too long. I guess the nature of the beast that it is, but it's delicious, and I actually find that with minimal garnish, even with just a really nice dry tonic, works really, really well. I was quite happy with last year's, but I only did about 40 or 80 cases, I think of it, 80 cases worth, or no, 80 bottles, I think.
Was it popular? Did it sell?
Yeah, we sold out, and that was just purely online with a few selected outlets. I hope to make a bit more because I picked more pomegranates, and it's a local tree just up the street. There's a tree in someone's house, and we just basically trade some gin for them to give us access to the tree because they basically don't eat them. And so I raided the whole tree. It's a fantastic tree, actually. And this year I was able to get about 9 kilos worth of the pulp from
the
tree. And I've got about 50, or not quite, maybe about 30 litres of steep, but it's rich red, like, you know, ethanol. So I've tweaked a couple of different things that I sort of took note of from the previous one, and I mean that's the other thing. It's sort of the shits and giggles kind of little projects that help keep me
same.
Yeah, well, not, you know, you're not making, because I only make two products really, and like the oak gin, you know, I don't make that a lot. You know, once I've got it, I just store it in the tank. I mean, spirits is great. The shelf life is great. It's indefinite. Mm. You can just let it sit there, and when it's ready to sort of pack. But it keeps me kind of stimulated that I'm doing something else. But, yeah, I'm coming back in to sort of making gin again, just because, you know, whenever the stockpile gets low, I just start churning it out more. But I've been doing some other non-gin things, which is I distilled some beer for some old IPA for Three Ravens for a project that they're releasing, so that they could fortify some booze that they have. And I've tried to do some more whiskey washes. So start making some new malt spirits. So,
I was ask you about that. You also have you got a whiskey experiment going on?
I've got a little R&D thing going on with small fermented barrels, and actually trying different grains, different yeast strains, and I'm resting them. But obviously, I can't do it. It's not technically whiskey because they're only short stays of like a year at in a barrel. Because the small barrels tend to extract a lot more rapidly, so you can kind of overcook it a bit. And so it's just to get an idea or a snapshot what some of the potential variations of yeast and grain sources and things that I can do. But again, yeah, when I'm doing everything pretty much by myself, it's only when I've got time permitting to be able to do it. But the gin, I think I've got that sort of dialed into where I want it, and then I just do gradual tweaks here and there, or if I'm updating my still, because I built the still myself, I can kind of look at it and then go, okay, well, I want to try something out. So I actually will build or purchase something to add into the still to kind of change its configuration in order to effectively kind of benefit a botanical that I'm trying to utilize. So I guess that's the advantage of having the ability to be able to sort of reconfigure or, you know, break down and do things with my still. It's still only a small 200 litre thing. But, you know, it does gin pretty good. And
I'm going to ask people who are watching, if they've got any questions, please let us know if you've got any further questions for Westy, Craig, and we can post them up there. But as part of the tradition of Wednesday Winos, we like to we're moving on to the next phase of our show, in that we like to leave on a high note of what you've noticed. So this one's something we're really interested in seeing in the last, this is week 7 of Wednesday Winos. So it's been 7 weeks, and I think, have you noticed anything in that period of time, or even in the last week, Craig, of what you would say that is giving you heart, making you happy?
I'll probably miss the slowdown of pace of life. I think everyone's kind of accepted that there's certain limitations with what we've got to do, and I think it's actually had some positive effects with I mean, there's obviously, you know, the bit people losing careers or livelihoods is terrible, and you know, 50% of my customer base has effectively had to shut the doors, which is horrendous, because there's a lot of good friends who either are musicians, which is, you know, I'm heavily connected with, can't work, and there's you know, people in the hospitality scene who can't work, and I count myself lucky that I'm actually at least able to still trade, even though it's very limited at the moment, and we're just kind of trying to ride it out. I communicate more with my neighbours, my kids playing in the street more with the other kids in the street. That kind of pace, it's a bit more country town, I guess, in the city, which is okay. I would like that to sort of stay, as opposed to when everything goes back to normal, if it ever does, who knows. I just hope everyone survives through it, really, and just sort of, you know, we're able to kind of pick up the slack for each other and, you know, understand, you know, pay your bills on time. I mean, some of the, you know, suppliers and that have really stepped up and shortened, so terms and the payment and things like that, so everyone's, there's some sort of cash flow of the economy. I guess the other important thing is, I mean, you can always buy direct from me, but I like to encourage friends and that, and people who buy from me, to actually go to the independent stores and go to even the major ones, because you can buy direct from me and, okay, it helps me out and, you know, you're getting your product. But there's also that person in the middle where there's a job there. There's job creation that's part of stimulating the economy, where then that person has an income and then can buy something else and I guess keep everything going. So yeah, if you go out and purchase something local from a local retailer, or an Australian retailer, it doesn't matter which, as long as you're kind of, you know, giving some reason that people can keep a job and keep doing business. Yeah. I think that's kind of,
so we had a question, you know,
people are mindful of. Yeah.
We had a question from Michael. And said, are you ever going to distill anything from Watts River Stout?
It hasn't been proposed, but I'm always open to anything. I'd always jump at doing something with the Watts River crew, because they're an all right lot, you know.
And you have to say that because we're listening.
And are you ever going to perform on the live stream for Watts River Brewing?
Oh, God, probably not.
do you do solos, Craig?
Hey?
Do you do solos, or does Ron play something?
No, I don't. I don't have time. I've got stuff I've been trying to do, and I just don't get time. My kid won't let me. It's just too hard to practice or do anything, so. My life's busy with this. I think once this sort of happens, I am planning or hoping to sort of team up with some people to do something. But, you know, it's still a big if.
We'd wait and see, but I think the pace is quite an Can you have a positive to the pace? The pace does have its positives. I guess.
Yeah. I think everyone's slowing down a little bit is probably kind of what the world needs.
Yeah. What about you, Hanna? What did you notice in the last week or so, 7 weeks or whatever?
I've been really enjoying the local Healesville food offerings. I've sick of cooking for 7 weeks, and there's just some amazing food available. We've dined very nicely from the local what were restaurants now offering amazing takeaways. So yeah, and trying to sort of I ease my guilt on not cooking by reassuring myself I'm supporting the local economy.
Well, that's good. I did that actually last Friday. Simon and I had a date night through McForbes. We tried that out and had the date night arrive here. And as usual, our driveway has driven everybody mad, and it was a bit of a misadventure for the delivery, but everything ended up fine and the food was delicious. So I think kudos to Chef Kate, because she did a great job as well. It's a lovely evening.
Your driveway is epic.
The really great thing is that we've had all the drainage repaired, and with all the rain that we've had, it's still there. It's still there. Our dams are full. It's amazing, and I love it. So, you know. But nonetheless, I really want to thank you, Craig, for coming along on Wednesday Winos. It was really, really great to talk to you and talk to you about the gin and the thoughts that go into it, what to drink with it, and how the connections with Healesville. And, hope that we – how do we actually get some of this gin?
You can go directly to our website or web store, and look, you know, there's numerous options. You can buy direct, but as I said before, I would encourage people to actually, and there's a list on there of all the retailers where we're stocked. So I think in Healesville, Brooke, he has us out there, but I mean, you know, Dan Murphy's throughout Victoria has our gin in store and online, or the white gin, not the oak gin, or many independents stock us as well, and I have them listed. So all you need to do is just go one stop, go to our cedarfoxdistillingco.com, and you just search through there. There's everything about our story, about the gins, there's recipe suggestions, but all our the bars and venues hopefully will still be there when they reopen. And all the retail outlets at the moment that are up there. So there's a lot of good ones in Melbourne and all over the place. So, and if your local doesn't have us, then you can just I think Paramount Liquor, who Spot on Liquor do the retail arm, they will be able to supply it as well. So, all those avenues fail, you can always get it direct from me.
Fantastic. Well, we've listed your website in the links below as part of this live feed. But moving on to next week, Hanna, would you like to do the honours and tell us what's happening next week for Wednesday Winos?
Well, I'd love to thank Craig for joining us once again. Really great to have a chat. And next week we're going to taste some Dayton Family Brewery beers that are part of our Mates Case. So the Mates Case is available on the Watts River Brewing website. We've put together some of our funkier beers, as well as some Dayton and some other breweries that we're mates with, like Sailor's Grave, who we spoke with, was that last week? So it's Wednesday, which means if you get your order in tonight by midnight, we're delivering tomorrow, sending out our guys out to do a delivery to Geelong and Melbourne. So you've still got time to get it in your hand tomorrow and taste it with us next Wednesday.
So thank you, Craig. Thanks, Hanna. Thank you, everybody, for joining us for Wednesday Winos and taking us out for next week. See you later.
Bye. Oh, man.